في الجنة نهرا من لبن.
هو مصلحته.
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. The Sheikh said that yesterday we mentioned about the five great axioms upon which the entire furu' or the branches of fiqh is based. And he said that there's another way of looking at this, which is what the great jurist and usuli scholar Izz ibn Abd al-Salam said, and that is that the entire sharia is in fact based on two principles. The first one is known as jalb al-masalih, which means to accrue benefits. And the second is dar' al-mafasid, which is to avoid harms. And so Izz ibn Abd al-Salam said that really the entire sharia, every ruling in the sharia can be seen as either something that accrues some benefit for humanity or something that wards off some harmful matter for humanity. And he then further stated that in fact we could reduce the entire sharia to the concept of jalb al-masalih, because in fact warding off harm is in reality a benefit for humanity. So really the sharia can be seen as jalb al-masalih, or the accruing of benefits for humanity. And then the Shaykh said that we believe that all of the rulings that the Prophet ﷺ brought are rulings that are for the benefit of humanity. But those benefits sometimes are manifest and clear, and we can see them and we can explain them and how they benefit us. There are other aspects of sharia, the benefits of which we believe, even if we haven't realized yet, because we know the source of it, which is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and He wants to benefit His creation. This is why He sent down this sacred law. So there are those, the benefits of which we might not see in this world, because we believe in otherworldly benefits also.
لهذا فقد قال ابن عباس رضي الله عنه في الدنيا معقول المعنى ومنها ما ليس معقول المعنى إلا أنه يتضمن مصلحة قطعا.
So the Shaykh said that therefore that all of these are benefits to humanity, and this is also based on the words of Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu when he said, if you hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala calling you to something, then know that He's calling you to some good, something that's beneficial to you. And he said that there are many verses in the Quran, for instance, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says Allah wants to make things easy for you. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not desire difficult for you. When Allah calls us in the Quran, He says, لَعَلَكُمْ تُفْلِحُونَ, that perhaps you might, or in order that you might be successful. So we can see all of these things that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is calling to us for our benefit. And this is also when He said that there are things that are clear outward. And this is called in the Arabic, مَعْقُولَ الْمَعْنَى. In other words, when the benefit is very clear, we call this ma'qul al-ma'na, which means it's rational in its meaning. So the rational mind can actually arrive at an understanding of the benefit in this world. And this is something in the Quran or in the Hadith, when we're commanded to do something, the intellect can recognize that. So the people of this science call that ma'qul al-ma'na. And he said, for instance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the ahkam of Islam, say that if you acquire a debt, then you have to fulfill it, you have to pay it. So that's, we can understand the benefit is ma'qul al-ma'na, the meaning is rational, the rational meaning. And for instance, Allah, the sharia ruling is that if a person destroys somebody's wealth, that he has to rectify what he's destroyed. We can understand the benefits of that. Even the non-Muslims arrive at many of these things because it's rational. And then he said, but there's another element to the rulings of the sharia, which in a sense is irrational. In other words, it's not something that we can arrive at with our intellect. For instance, he mentioned that the sharia necessitates that we pray four rak'ats for dhuhr, we pray four rak'ats for asr, we pray three for maghrib, we pray four for isha, and we pray two for fajr. Why those numbers? We are not told why Allah chose those numbers. But we know that there is a reason why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did that. And there are many other aspects of the, particularly the rulings that deal with worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said that the grandson, Ibn Rushd, there's two the Jadd and the Hafid, the grandson, Ibn Rushd, who's the great faqih who wrote Bidayat al-Mujtahid and other books, he said that the reason that these rulings are given to us is for tazkiyatun nafs. So the maslaha, or the benefit, is in the purification of the soul. And so there is a worldly benefit in it, and that is the purification of the soul, and also istislam, which is submitting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is beneficial for the slave, to submit to Allah. Because by submitting to Allah, somebody will enter into a state, he's no longer at war with the creator of the heavens and the earth. And if you're not at war with the creator of the heavens and the earth, you're in a peace treaty. And if you're in a peace treaty with somebody, then one of the things that treaty warrants is that that person is going to not harm you. And so he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to Ibrahim alayhi salam in the Quran, aslam, submit. And Ibrahim alayhi salam responds, I have indeed submitted to the Lord of the worlds. So in that state of submission is a benefit. And so this is why we can then look at the sharia as being either ma'qul al-ma'na, which is that it's rational in its rulings, and we can arrive at that, and we can explain those to non-Muslims as well. And if they have intelligence, they'll see indeed that's beneficial. And then there are other elements that are done for a hikmah, some wisdom that is hidden from us, but the essence of that wisdom, according to some of our ulama, is the purification of the soul, and it's entering into a state of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is indeed beneficial. So the Shaykh then said that we can see that all of this is for the benefit of the human being, and this is what we accept. And in looking at the wisdom of the legislation, that why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has legislated these things for us, there are two things that we have to absolutely understand. One of them is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has no need for us. In other words, we do not believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala needs His creation in order to benefit us. That He does not need to do that. And we also believe that there's nothing that we can do that can harm Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he said, but we do believe that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is absolutely wise in what He's doing. That there's a wisdom behind the legislations that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. And there's... he said, for instance, when we look at the... And he said those wisdoms either manifest or they're hidden, like he said earlier. So if we look at the prayer, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us to establish the prayer when the sun is inclining, duruk al-shams, when it's inclining, and also when the night comes. And then, well, Qur'an al-fajri, and also the Qur'an at the fajr time, because that Qur'an is witnessed by the angels. And so he said, if you look, this ayah indicates the five prayers. And he said that we don't know why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has put there, but we, even within the times, you can see that there is a wisdom that manifests. For instance, the prayers of the daytime are spread apart. And this is obviously the human being is preoccupied in the day, he's working. And so the time between Fajr and Dhuhr, you have all of that time, you don't have any prayer to do any prayers, because the human being's working. And then Dhuhr and Asr, again you have time because it's still daytime. Whereas the night prayers are close together because a human being is finished with his work, his day's work, and Maghrib and Isha are close together. And then you have a long gap for when the human being sleeps. And then you have the Fajr prayer, which is the beginning of the new day. So there's all of these wisdoms even within the ibadah that can be seen. And then the Shaykh quoted Sidi Mayyara, who is the commentator of many of the scholarly texts of the Maliki Madhab, wrote a completion of a famous poem that is about these qawaid. And in them, the Shaykh quoted them and fast, and I don't memorize them. So, but the basic gist of it was that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the way that we look at Allah is like a majestic king. And the king commands, and there's a wisdom in his command. And he's doing it for the benefit of the creatures. And it's the wise people that understand that. This is what a faqih is. A faqih is somebody that has a wisdom. He understands, he can see the wisdom in things. And then he said that all of these things have come for us, like Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu said, that when you hear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala call you, you should know that He's calling you to good. So these things are understood in our tradition, that there's benefit here.
هذا التمهيد مهم جدا ونحن نتعلم فهذه حالة الأنبياء الاستسلام إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى.
So the Sheikh then said that therefore the reason that this introduction is so important, he feels, is that human beings, if they don't understand this, there will always be people who ask, why is this the way that the Sharia? Why does the Sharia say this? Well, what's the wisdom behind this? So he said, for instance, people ask, why divorce three times? Why does a woman have a iddah for 3 months? Why does a woman who dies as her husband dies wait for 4 months and 10 days? There are many things that people will ask. Why 4 rakats at dhuhr? All these different questions that people ask. And the Shaykh said, the important thing is, you understand these are for benefits. And what you don't, what you must understand is there are certain benefits that might not be known to you. And so there's an acceptance in that. And he said that there are some that are. And he said, if you look at, for instance, Shah Wali Allah Kandahdawi, one of the great mujtahid of India, wrote a book called Hujjatullah al-Baligha. And in this, he clarified many of the wisdoms of the Sharia, why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared these things. And also Imam al-Qarafi, radiallahu anhu, in his book Al-Furuq and other books, he went into the wisdoms of the Sharia. What is the secrets behind these things? And Imam Shatibi, who's the famous Imam of the Maqasid of Sharia, or the aims and purposes of Sharia, who also went into great detail explaining about these wisdoms. And he said, so in the end, we reach a point where we have to agree on 2 points, two qa'idah. The first qa'idah is that we understand that the Sharia is not in vain. That the Sharia is not abath. It's not in vain. It was not created in vain. It was not given to us in vain. And the second one is that we have to submit. That there's an element that Allah is calling us to, which iman. And iman necessitates a submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, whether you understand or not. Because submitting is giving up. And part of it is giving up your understanding, that you don't really fully understand everything. And he said, if you look at the prophets, this is their state. You look at Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was commanded by Allah, aslim. He didn't ask him why. Why should I submit? He said, I have submitted to the Lord of all the world. If you look at Ya'qub alayhi salam, on his deathbed, he told his sons, don't die except that you're in a state of submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he asked them, what do you worship? And they said, we worship one God. There's only one God but Allah. And we're in a state of submission to Him. And he said also, Nabiyuna Nuh alayhi salam, when he was in the boat calling his son to the boat, and the son said, I'm going to go to this mountain, and the mountain will protect me. And Nuh alayhi salam said, called on Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He said, oh Allah, this is my son. He wants to save his son. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, he's not your son. He's not a righteous deed. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, and don't ask about things that you don't know. In other words, the wisdom of your son being with the people who drown, there's a wisdom in it that you don't understand. And don't ask about that wisdom. And then Nuh, thinking that he did something wrong, he said that he doesn't want to be from the ignorant ones. So this is a sign of ignorance, those people who question the wisdom of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he's warning him not to do that. And so this is the state of the prophets, who are the most learned of human beings, the most intelligent. This is their state. There are things they understand, and there are things even the prophets submit to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and surrender their will to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala completely and accept that they can't know it.
سندخل الآن في هذه بعض هذه القواعد سنتحدث عنها وهي تشتمل على حكم من حكم الشريعة وتشتمل على فروع من الفروع التي بنيت على هذه الحكم وبنيت على هذه المصالح. سنحاول تقريب هذه القواعد للقلوب وللنفوس حتى يستطيع كل منكم أن يتذوق الشريعة أن يعرف لماذا كذا ولماذا كذا وما هي الخصائص التي تختص بهذه الشريعة المباركة الشريعة الخاتمة التي ختمت الرسالات السماوية إلى الأرض.
So the Sheikh said, now we're going to look at some of the wisdom of our legislation, of our sacred law, and by looking at some of the branches also in these great rules, in these great axioms, how the branches are based upon them and what are the wisdoms behind it. And he said that what he is going to do in clarifying to you these things is he wants you all to taste the wisdom of this Sharia and to get a taste of the sacred law and the power of the sacred law and why this is such a wise law from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
القاعدة عن غيرها من الأنظمة لأنها تهتم ببواطن.
So the Sheikh said that the first qa'idah that we're going to look at is a very majestic qa'idah, and that is the qa'idah al-umur bi-maqasidiha, which means that deeds and actions are judged by their purpose, goal, or intention. And the Sheikh said that the first to look at the first word al-umur, he said the umur is the plural of amrun in the Arabic language. And he said, Amrun has two meanings. The first meaning is a request or a command, like Amartuka, to I commanded you to do something. And this is called Talab. And the second one is Hadath, which is an event, something that occurs, an occurrence. And he said, for instance, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Ata Amrullah, that Allah's, that the Amr of Allah came. And he said that there's two ways that this is used in the plural. One of them is umur, and the other is awamir. And generally, awamir, even though he said some of the linguists do not agree that amr can be given the plural awamir, and so they say umur is the only plural, he said that it has been used by the jurists and the fuqaha to say awamir of Allah, the commands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So what he's saying here, and then the next thing is the maqasid. He said the maqasid is the plural of maqsid, and it comes from the verb qasada, which is that which you intend, or that which you set out for, or that which you direct yourself to go to. And so he said, basically what this qa'ida is saying is that things are not, those matters of the Sharia are not concerned with the outward form. What is the concern of the Sharia is the inward, not the outward. And he said that this is clear in the hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which is in the sound tradition of Imam Muslim, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not look at your suwar, the outward form, but he looks at the hearts, the qulub, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala looks at your hearts. So he's looking at what your intentions are. So the outward form is not the primary concern of the Sharia. The Sharia is concerned with the inward. And the Sheikh said that this means that our law is completely different from the other laws of the world, because the other laws of the world are concerned with the outward. All they can do is judge on the outward. They don't have a concern with the inwardness of man. So at the foundation of our Sharia is that matters in this law that Allah has given us are based on the inward intentions, goals, and purposes. And so he said this is a radical departure from all of the other systems in the world. So the Sheikh said that therefore, the intention of an action either rectifies the action or ruins the action, corrupts it, irrespective of what the action actually appears to be in the outward. And so he said, for instance, if the intention was good and the action was not good outwardly, it could be an action that draws you near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the opposite is also true. The outward intention might be good, but the outward act looks good, but the inward intention is bad. It's something that's unacceptable to Allah. So he said an excellent example of this is in the Quran with the story of Al-Khadr and Musa. عليه السلام عليهم السلام. When Musa عليه السلام took companionship with Al-Khidr, he looked at the outward actions of Al-Khidr. So for instance, Al-Khidr killed a young boy in an antinomial fashion. It was a time, outwardly, it looked like it was a homicide. And then he had a ship that people were on, and he actually poked a hole in the ship. And Musa saw him do this. And then he took a, there was a wall that had come down, and he wouldn't rectify it. So Musa couldn't understand. And finally, in the end, he asked him, each one he was saying to him when he killed the boy, do you kill an innocent soul? And this is a terrible thing you've done. Then when he saw him do with the Safina, he said, do you destroy a ship, sink a ship, its people, in order to drown the people? What a terrible thing. So each one, Musa is looking at the outward, the surah. This is the outward form. When Al-Khidr finally explains the intention, because he was a servant who was given knowledge directly from Allah, when he explains what his intentions were, and the Shaykh is really, he's given a commentary on Al-Umur bi Maqasidiha, when he explained what were the maqasid in these umur, the outward affair, Al-Khidr explains that as for the boy, he was actually going to be a wretched boy. And Al-Khidr was given knowledge of that. That he was going, his parents were good people, and he was going to end up being a wretched boy that would cause them great suffering and pain. And so Al-Khidr desired that he would be replaced by another child, and he did this. This is obviously not our sacred law, but this is something that was done by the command of Allah. And then the boat, he did an outward thing, but Al-Khidr knew, and he told him, there's a ship that there's a king on it, and the king is a usurper. He's a pirate. And he's going and taking the ships of the sea for his own navy. So when he poked the hole, when this king would come, he would see that this ship was not useful to his navy. So he would leave the ship. So Al-Khidr was actually saving the ship for them in a way that Musa didn't realize. And then also the child, the two orphans that had there was a treasure underneath the place. And had they dug that up, they would have found this treasure that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was waiting for it to come to the people at the appropriate time. So when these maqasid were explained to Musa, he realized that he was judging by the outward and the inward reality was hidden from him. And this is the wisdom of that story and an explanation of this principle. That the foundation of this qa'idah is actually from the Qur'an and the hadith. And he said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Qur'an, whoever desires Allah, is hoping for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then let him do righteous deeds. And let him not associate with Allah anything. So the deed is the outward, the not associating is the inward. So the deed is the amar, and the lack of association, in other words, ikhlas, an-niyyah, is the inward reality of it. So Allah is telling us to have the inward and the outward. But the important thing there is that there's no shirk with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's words, that they were only commanded, وَمَا أُمِرُوا إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُ اللَّهِ مُخْلِصِينَ الدِّينَ. They were only commanded to worship Allah with sincerity and having a deen solely for the sake of Allah. So that is the outward is the act, the ibadah, the inward is the ikhlas of the state of the heart. And then the Shaykh said that therefore a righteous action is based on the rectification of the intention. And so an action is either right or wrong based on what's going on in the heart. And then he said that this hadith in Imam Amaru bin Niyat, surely actions are by intentions, is from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ telling us it's basically the same meaning. Actions are by intentions. Al-umur bi maqasidiha. And so the Shaykh said that Imam al-Bukhari began his book with this hadith because of its place in Islam. This is the foundation of the sacred law. And he said that there are some ulama that say that this is actually a third of all knowledge. And the reason for that is knowledge is one of three things. It's either amal, which is the outward action, a qawl, which is what you say. People forget that speaking is action. It is a type of action. And then the intention behind your amal and your qawl. So niyyah is one third of the matter. And that's why this is one third of knowledge. Because knowledge is acts, actions, actions, words, and intentions. That is, knowledge is all based on one of those three things. And then he said, and then there's those who say it's actually one fourth of knowledge, coming from that some of the ulama have said that all of knowledge really is, can be surmised, it can be epitomized by only four hadiths. The first hadith is that actions are by intentions. So that's one fourth that Umar bin Maqasid has, one fourth. And then the next one is that halal, what is permissible, is clear, and what is impermissible is ambiguous. Impermissible is clear. The two of them are bayyin. They're manifest, they're clear. And between the two are matters, umur mushtabihat, they're gray areas. The fuzzy logic. They're in that realm of the fuzziness. It's neither clearly halal nor clearly haram. And so, like the hadith says, which is a sahih hadith, that whoever stays away from those gray matters has kept his deen, his transaction with Allah, in a state of purity or innocence. And those who fall into gray matters have fallen into the haram, according to the riwayah of Imam Muslim. And in another riwayah, which is sound, they are like a ra'i, a person, a shepherd, around the sanctuary of a king. That they take their sheep, because in the old days, kings used to have sanctuaries. Like the Sherwood Forest, you couldn't go into that sanctuary without getting, you'd be killed for hunting on the king's sacred grounds. So the point is that a shepherd who goes even near the sanctuary is a fool, because his sheep might go into the sanctuary and he'll bring on himself the wrath of the king. So the person who goes around these, and that's one of them. And then the other one is that have zuhud, lack of desire. Lose your desire for this world, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will love you. Lose your desire for what people have, and people will love you. In other words, if you don't covet people's goods, they like you. If you don't covet the dunya, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves you. So that's foundational also. And then finally, leave what gives you doubt for what gives you certainty. So these four hadiths, according to some of our ulama, are that's the foundation of knowledge. And so the first one, which is innama al-a'malu binniyat, is one fourth of knowledge. If you know these four things, you know all of knowledge. If you know that one, you know one fourth. And so some say that the hadith, that this qa'ida is actually one fourth, and others say it's one third. Now to look at this this qaida, this axiom, what is built upon it? What is it the foundation of from the rulings of Sharia? He said, in fact, there are many, many rulings that this is actually foundational to. He said the first is the actions that we do. There are actions in the Sharia, if they are independent of intention, if they're done without intention, they're free of intention, the action itself is invalid. The lack of intention will actually invalidate the action itself. And this is because of this qaida. Another one is related to sahat al-uqud, which are those contracts that we do in our daily lives, buying and selling, marriage, things that deal with an aqad between people, that the intention can actually change the aqad itself. It can invalidate it in certain instances. So it's related also to transactions between people. And the third is whether an action is acceptable with Allah or whether it's unacceptable with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this last one is also, he said that the intention itself can take an action which under normal circumstances is a merely permissible thing to do. It neither has a reward nor a punishment related to it. It's jaiz, it's permissible. It can take a jaiz act, and because the niyyah, before the action is changed, the action which is normally permissible becomes actually something that draws you near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and becomes an accepted act with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And so this is around these three things, this qa'ida is related to and is the foundation of, and he said this is what we're going to look at. So the Shaykh said that this hadith, innama al-amalu bin-niyyat, if we look at this hadith and how it relates to this first aspect, he said that the Prophet ﷺ, when he told this hadith, he gave an example within the hadith itself, and he said that whoever makes an immigration to Allah and His Messenger, that's what he made an immigration to, Allah and His Messenger. But whoever makes an immigration for some worldly thing, or to marry a woman, then his hijrah is to what he made that intention to get from it. Now, the Shaykh said that we all know that the Prophet ﷺ, during the time in Mecca, people were harming him. There was actually a boycott. There were sanctions, economic sanctions, that were placed upon the Prophet ﷺ and his companions. They were suffering a great deal, that they actually conspired to kill the Prophet of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And so Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, at a certain point after 13 years of a lot of difficulty, Allah commanded the Prophet to make hijrah and commanded his followers. At this point, most of the Sahaba made hijrah. Although there were some people that were not necessarily in a bad situation, they didn't necessarily want to make hijrah. And one of them in particular was a man named Qais. There was a woman who was named Qais, and this man wanted to marry her. This man went to this woman, Qais, and he said, "I want to marry you." And she said, "I won't marry you unless you make hijrah to Medina." And the Shaykh said that there were many, many very strong women at the time of the Prophet ﷺ. These women, one of them he mentioned was Sulaim, and one of the great Fursan of the people of Medina from the Ansar came and proposed to her, and he said, "What would you take as a dowry?" And he was a non-Muslim, and she said, "I won't take anything less than Islam as a dowry." And he loved this woman, so he actually became Muslim, and he ended up becoming one of the great Sahaba of the Prophet ﷺ. So these women were very strong, and this woman, Qais, said, "You have to make hijrah if you want to marry me." And so he made hijrah to marry Qais. Now when he got to Medina, he realized what a great benefit that was being revealed in the Qur'an about the Muhajirun, because these ayats hadn't been revealed before that. But after they actually made hijrah, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, as for those who were harmed in Allah's path, and they made hijrah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, desiring only Allah, they will have great rewards with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This man began to have remorse. And he said, "Well, I did make hijrah, so inshallah I'm going to get their reward." This was mentioned to the Prophet ﷺ, and he mentioned this hadith. If a man makes hijrah for a woman, that's his reward, the woman. And so the Sahaba called this man Muhajiru Qais, the man who made hijrah, because they were Muhajirun ilallahi wa rasulihi. And he was Muhajir ila Qais. He was making hijrah to Qais. And so that was his reward. And this is, again, just explaining this hadith and this qa'idah, which is al-umur bi maqasidiha. So the amr here is the hijrah. The maqsid was either Allah and His Messenger or some worldly matter. So he got the hijrah to Qais, and the other ones got the hijrah to Allah and His Messenger. So now we're going to look at what is the niyyah, what is the reality of the niyyah. And he said the niyyah has a haqiqah, it has a reality, it has a time, it has a ruling, it has a place, it has a form, the type, and it has a purpose, and it has a condition. So he said to look at these, the first is the haqiqah. What is the reality of the niyyah? And he said the niyyah is qasad, its purpose, its intention, its intentionality. What is your intention when you're doing something? That is the reality of a niyyah. It is what, why are you doing it? What is the reason, the underlying reason? And then the next is the mahal, the place. What is the place of the intention? He said the place of the intention is the heart. So the heart is the place of the intention, not the tongue. He said you don't have to say when you're going to pray, I'm intending out loud with your tongue or silently, I'm intending to pray 4 rak'ats of dhuhr. The place of the niyyah is the heart. That is the mahal. That is where it comes. Because the heart is the source of man's will. That's where the will emanates from. And so intention emanates from the heart because will emanates from the heart. And then the hukum. What is the hukum of a niyyah? The hukum of the niyyah is in order to make something an act of worship to Allah, the hukum is wajib. It's wajib to intend. If you don't intend, then it's going to there will be a distinction. And he goes into that in a moment. The time. What is the time of your niyyah? The time is at the outset of the action. So for instance, you could give somebody money, he said, and then later on you realize, oh, I meant sadaqah. You hadn't thought of it when you gave it, but you realize, why give away money and I don't get a reward with Allah as well? So then you make the, oh, I intend sadaqah for that money I gave yesterday. It's too late. You have to give it before you actually do the action, at the outset of the action. And then he said that also, what is the kayfiyah of the action, of the intention, the quality of the intention, or the howness of the intention. That he said that depends on what's being intended. It's hasab al-manwi. So if what you're intending is a fard, then the intention, the kayfiyah, has to be a fard. You have to intend an obligation. So if you're making a hajj, which is obligatory, then you have to say faridah. I'm intending the obligation. If you want to fast voluntarily, then you intend to fast voluntarily. It's in order to do that. And then he said if it's mandub, something recommended, also if it's sunnah mu'akkada, things like that. It relates to the hasab al-manwi. And then he said the condition of a niyyah is, of the, your intention is Islam. Because these are matters that relate to drawing near to Allah, and the deen with Allah is Islam. So if you, if a non-Muslim decides to fast, he might be living with some Muslims in a house, and he decides, I'm going to fast Ramadan with all of you. And you get up in the morning and everybody makes the intention of Ramadan, and he makes the intention as well. Like, nawaitu siyam lillah. If he's not a Muslim, he's just hungry during the day. He's not getting any benefit because the condition of the niyyah, the shart, the condition is Islam. And then also the maqsud al-niyyah. What is the aim or purpose of intention? What's its purpose? The Shaykh said the purpose is in order to distinguish your actions. What the intention does is it gives a distinguishing quality to the acts that human beings do. So it divides an act that is permissible, ja'iz, or impermissible, from an act that is an obligation by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or a recommended act. And so, for instance, if a doctor tells somebody not to eat or drink, that person does that act, it looks just like fasting. The doctor says, I want you not to drink anything before dawn or eat until sunset, because we're going to run a series of tests or something like that. That outwardly, the act is identical to fasting. But without the intention of fasting for the sake of Allah, it does not distinguish the act. The act is the same, the act outwardly is the same, but it's changed because of the inward. One distinguishes it from the other. So the purpose of the intention, the maqsid, is the intention itself. And it will also, so it distinguishes what's known as ada from ibadah. Ada is norms or customs. It's what you do as a habit. It's your habitual thing. You might give money just as a habit. Every time the box comes around, You just habitually pull out $5 and give the money. You don't think about it while you're doing it. You just see everybody else doing it. That's a ada. Ibadah is when you pull it out, you're making an intention to give sadaqah for the sake of Allah. So this is the purpose of a niyyah, is to distinguish your actions from ada and ibadah. It makes a distinction between habitual practice and devotional practice. That is the point of it. And he said it also distinguishes another, under this rubric, another aspect is that it distinguishes the types of ibadah themselves. There are voluntarily acts of worship, devotional acts that are voluntary. There are devotional acts that are obligatory. There are also acts that can take something that in could be voluntary or obligatory. That you change your niyyah by changing your niyyah. You could do it either voluntarily, but by changing your niyyah slightly, you can make an obligation. So it's a tamyiz, or it's a distinguishing factor in our actions. Actions. Actions.